Good morning, everyone. And first of all, thank you for inviting me and bringing some of my great friends like Razi and Shafi Ahmed also into one place to share with you some of the things that we see happening in health and healthcare. I do that from a lens. I grew up in our own family company. We had automotive companies, but also ambulance services. And so gradually, I migrated into Radboud University Medical Center, responsible for acute healthcare at one end, and also turned up to create an innovation cell on the convergence of technology at one end and patient empowerment at the other one. After 12 great years, I again quit my job because I no longer thought and still think that change in healthcare comes from healthcare itself. It comes from the outside in. And for that, I'm now helping Deloitte as one of their Edge Fellows. We're not employed. We don't have any commercial roles. We advise Deloitte and their clients, often governments, companies, in what's next. And still 1.5 day employed by my hometown hospital in Roermond, where I strolled around for 20 years. And as of September 1st, also a fellowship for Vodafone in the same sphere. So in the early days, I tried to color outside of the lines, as you can see in this early picture of mine. And now I try to take a bigger lens to see much more what's coming up from outside in. And if you follow the news, social media, TV, papers, we all know that the world is at fire with huge challenges up to our sleeves. And we've also are trying to still manage this pandemic, which overnight, in a weekend almost, had to put us up on our feet to find a totally different delivery model in healthcare, as also for university and universities and also other companies. So all of a sudden, for instance, the technology part on that really needed to be up our game. And the amount of creativity in healthcare, for instance, at nursing level, at level of physicians, not to bother with all the things in terms of the managerial aspects, brought a huge amount of creativity that still resonates in healthcare. But how to secure the way that we delivered healthcare at that moment in time? On the other part, the patient part, patient learned all of a sudden that they had a choice. Well or not to be vaccinated, well or not to take a mask. And they turned to the internet to try to find out what was good. And they found credible information, but we all know there's also crap outside. So how to determine in the end of the day what's good for you? And that's one of the things where we in healthcare have done a lousy job. Still at Radboud University, when I started, that's about 10 years ago, we had 1,750 brochures on paper that we would give to our patients. Meanwhile, patients turned to the internet, so why not use that model as well? And during the pandemic, patients also learned something else. They said, well, my neighbor has gotten that treatment, so I now also want that same treatment as well, which is a hard time, of course. You can imagine that that's not also always credible. And all of this happened to healthcare at a moment in time in history where healthcare massively is under pressure. Organizationally under pressure, financially under pressure, in terms of the demand, we are facing a doubling of healthcare demand by 2035, somewhere around that. So that's not an easy challenge, as you can imagine. So this is a slide that I've been using since 2017, where I said, by 2030, we will have a doubled healthcare demand within the same budget, with an understaffing of about like 30%, and a burnout rate that's going through the roof, and patients know what they want. I could not have imagined back then that that's exactly what happened during this pandemic. And mind you, the pandemic was, and still is, a temporary crisis. By 2035, that will be a permanent crisis if we stay on the trajectory that we're on right now. So we should change things. So what could we use? Well, maybe digital as one of the aspects that we can use. We pay with plastic. By the way, even less more because now we're paying with our watches and our phones and very soon with our eyes. The same goes for groceries. The shopping is done online and in the Netherlands, I'm sure that's also true in a couple of places in Slovakia as well, we're able to order our groceries and with a 12-minute window, they will bring it and put it in my own fridge. That's the way that we work already. So that's a huge part of digital. And traveling. Coming here, we need our passport, we need our tickets, and now still it's a passport that's in hard copy, but in the US, you might have known already that in the wallet of the iPhone, sits your driver license and very soon also your passport. So actually we are already living in this digital society. What's needed to get these things up and running, and how does that relate to healthcare? Well, I think we're on crossroads now. We really have to make a choice. Are we going to deliver healthcare in the same way that we do it right now? And are we going to deliver healthcare, or are we going to deliver health, which is a paradigm shift? And we all know that that's needed. But what is needed to get this up and running? One part, I think, is that we need to switch. We need to flip the system. As opposed to delivering healthcare physical and adding something digital to it, I think we should flip it around. To design and to redesign every process in healthcare with a digital perspective in mind and as a start. To say, well, maybe we do it at first digital, unless. And the unless could be all kinds of things. The unless could be scientifically validated that this does not work for this patient, for that disease, or for that treatment. The unless could be that the patient doesn't want it. I worked a lot with young cancer patients, the IAS, adolescent young adults. And by protocol, they have to show up every 6 weeks at their oncologist's office. And the discussion often goes like, so how are things going? And the patient would say, well, fine. But last week I needed you for an hour and I wasn't able to get a hold on you. So what could happen if we change that and to say, so unless anything other happens, we'll see you digitally. But if it's needed, our front door is still open. You can visit us and we have more time for you to spend with us. So that's a paradigm flip. What's needed for that in healthcare? We have to rethink interface. If there's anything that we're bad at in healthcare, it's an interface. Interface is not only how things look like, but it's also how it works. And I always like to joke about this, that whenever we create something in healthcare, like an app or something like, it's a bit like we have to explain it. It's like a joke, a bad joke. If you have to explain the joke, it's not funny anymore. And that's what we do in healthcare. Over and over, we create something so hard and almost scientific and academic that the majority of the patients are not able to cope with it. And then we say, well, our society is not ready for it. My own mother-in-law is 92 years of age, and she a couple of months ago had a hip replacement. And we gave her an iPad. There's things to regret. I got pictures of flowers and all kinds of stuff that I can share with you. But she knows how to utilize that. We did not have to explain the user interface of using that system, not only to talk to us, but also with her physician. So this is also about user experience. And the thing we could take more into account in healthcare, I think, is that a patient often also is a consumer in their everyday life. The moments and time that they are within healthcare, even though they live with that condition, often are only intermediate steps. And we often think that we are the center of the universe, but we're not. So as a consumer, they see how convenience kicks in almost every aspect of their life, because companies are trying to make it as easy as possible and to lower the thresholds as much as possible for them to make sure that they buy their products. And every now and then, I'm a patient myself. I got some kidney stones every now and then. And when I look to healthcare from a patient perspective, 80% is blunt logistics. Has nothing to do with medicine. Totally nothing from a patient perspective. But let's be honest, we have to take our car to drive to the hospital, burn fossil fuels, by the way, to find a parking spot. It's always the last, way back in the end. I got a 10 a.m. appointment, 2 minutes to 10, exhausted. I'm at the front desk of the department at the hospital. And then somebody says, well, take a seat, they're running late. That's the reality that a lot of our patients see happening. And by the way, I mentioned burning fossil fuels. I'm now running some research with a couple of academic centers and the Ministry of Health in the Netherlands, where we try to create a climate case for digital health. And we've already calculated that for first-time outpatient visits, I'm sorry for that, first-time outpatient visits in the Netherlands alone, which is by the way one-third, The average hospital is like 5 kilometers. It adds up to 91 million kilometers only for a referral from the GP to the hospital. One third. Not everybody has a fossil fueled car, of course, but again, it's one third. Just imagine also in terms of the global sustainability goals, what we could do. And that's also where technology a bit comes to the rescue, I think. We're now living in that fourth industrial revolution after the steam engine, the mass production, the internet came, and now everything connects with everything. Your fridge very soon will be able to order the groceries. Your television already knows what program that you want to see, and your phone predicts when you start to travel. That's the reality. And things, let me get out of the way for this, and things have changed on our desk. And we all notice that this happens. And now all of these technology sits in your phone, and very soon, and I reckon that Shafi will dive into virtual reality and stuff like that, it will sit in your glasses. I think it was 2015, I was the first European Google Glass explorer. Remember Google Glass? I was one of those glass holes, as they liked to call it back in those days. But what we've done is that we've used that within our operating theater, and our students could see what was happening from the viewpoint of the surgeon, as opposed to standing on the back end, on the little crutch, to see through the curls of the hair what was happening. The reality for that is that it not only prepared us as a society for these kind of technologies, but we've pushed the boundaries for that into it. And that's also what's happened with technology. And I think this is an iconic tweet of the vice president of Ukraine to Elon Musk, who said, please come to the rescue with your technology. You're building this internet from space, not only Elon Musk, but also others. And we need coverage of internet. For me, this was a very pivotal moment in time. Not because of the war over there, but also it shows what's happening that I like to call a Copernican moment. And Copernic was a scientist in the mid-1500s that proved that the sun was not circling the earth. Here it is. There's not. But it was the other way around. And in healthcare, still, the patient circles the professional. And technology can help to also have the opportunity to do it the other way around. And again, if science backs it up, if the patient wants it, and yes, of course, also somebody has to pay for that, let's also be honest. So at the start of the pandemic, I said, we've been pregnant for digital health for years, and now all of a sudden, during this pandemic, it came through life through a C-section. Because we had to. We didn't have any other means and possibilities. Back in the early days, the physician, back in those days, all the technology that he had would fit in his doctor's bag and he could take with him into your home. Now we got big shopping mall kind of buildings where all the big technology in those hospitals would reside. And on the other hand, we know that things get smaller, like the computer that was shifted into with a big van, and now this and the same could fit into your fingers, and now on top of it, and we've gone from building stuff to make sure that we can move it, and then we could carry it, and then it was wearable. And the next phase, I coined insidable, because that's what we're doing right now. It's early work at a lot of universities across the world, but that's also what happens. We're shrinking stuff. Like Elon Musk now, as you could think that this is a big fridge that he's standing in front of, but actually, this is the world's first 3D printer that's possible, that's able to print COVID vaccines. And Musk's mission is to down-drill this scale within 5 to 10 years on the scale of these old-fashioned copy machines that would sit on our desk, remember the Canon kind of things? And then it would sit into the comfort of your own home as patient, and based on the measurements of your watch and all the other things, it would print out one pill in the morning that you would take as opposed to the 17 ones that you should have across the day. Whether or not he will be able to do that in 5 to 10 years, because sometimes he is a bit of an issue in terms of scheduling and planning, but up until now, the majority of the things that the guy touched came to reality sooner or later. Because that's the reality. We're shrinking things. At Radboud University, I was responsible for a project where we would monitor patients, not on the ICU, but on the regular and the general ward. on internal medicine and surgery. And we were able to, with artificial intelligence, to predict whether or not that patient during the day would have to be rushed back into the ICU. Then the pandemic came. And we started to use that not only on regular wards, but also with help of some of the technology. And I started with these little band-aids. And then our company, in the Dutch Pride, Philips, created this little chap that connects to the chest of the patient. And gives us the opportunity to 2 weeks on a row to run 6 vital signs remotely without any other connection needed. So now, all of a sudden, we could discharge patients into the comfort of their own home as opposed to keeping them in the hospital because we had a huge issue, as you can imagine, still with it. The other thing that happens, from incidental measurements, now all of a sudden we got almost a continuously flow of technology. So from measuring and monitoring in hospitals and responsibility from the hospitals in the walls of the hospitals, all of a sudden we can go outside of the hospitals, and then we got this home monitoring aspect. So academical research will, academical healthcare will shift into top clinical healthcare, will shift into supermarkets. We'll get to that in a minute, and at the homes of people. But to be honest, the first next stage is the phone. I was one of the first to have this little strip at the back end for my iPhone, from Dave Albert, a cardiologist from Houston. And I think Shafi, you had, well, I think that was in the same session that we got it from Dave. And we were able to run a 1-lead AKG from our iPhone. So when I got back to Nijmegen and I rushed to my friend and colleague, the professor of cardiology, and showed it to him, and I thought, that's something that he's going to use. Not so much. Where is the science? Who's paying for it? Is it credible? Fast forward 5 years, the same technology sits similar to in the Apple Watch. By the way, the guy is suing Apple right now because it's something about IP. And now we have that at scale. And not only at scale, the 1-lead AKG is now being created by this little system that looks the same. Now he can take a 6-lead AKG, and he's now created a 12-lead AKG. But the main message of this is this. This little system, this little thing that I have in my pocket and in my hands, able to run a validated 6-lead AKG for $90 set in the Black Friday deal of Amazon. And if you want to know if something gets mainstream, if it's in the Black Friday deal of Amazon, trust me, then it's going mainstream. Within 6 years from a funny little project going into reality and at scale. And now we see companies like Apple. By the way, I don't own any shares of all the companies that I'm bragging about. So the EKG in it, in the watch, and then we got the oxygenation level in it, and supposedly very soon glucose level measure without pricking needles in patients. And recently the new watch that was launched, I think 2 weeks ago, now also have temperature management in the watch. So there's a pattern here. And the pattern, I think, is that we will be present for the first time in history when somebody gets sick, as opposed to they will come to us once they are sick and when we have to fix stuff. So how are we going to cope with it? How are we going to utilize that where technology gets smaller and smaller, like Philips created an ultrasound knob connected to a smartphone, and there's a, that's your phone, and there's a region in the Netherlands where 18 GPs started to use this system. And the referral rate from the GP to the radiology department in the hospital dropped down with 30%. So now you can imagine that there's a kind of stress at that department, like maybe we should collaborate with the guys. Another technology sits at the back end of the iPad, where there's a laser kind of technology where now physiotherapists, with blazing accuracy, remotely can do exercises with their patients asynchronously. So if I would have to do some exercise and I would do that in front of my iPad and the data would get sent into my physiotherapist that would get a hold of me that next morning or in real life to help me and to advise me with it. So the other thing that's happening, what we used to call domotica, delivered to elderly homes and to nursing homes and to hospitals, now you can buy at the Media Markt and the likes. It is becoming a commodity. And we see the same thing also happening from out of hospitals. This is our self-measurement kiosk in our hospital, a big chair kind of thing where patients would sit on and they were able to take their own blood pressure and their oxygenation level and their weight. And with their little hospital cards, it gets directly into the electronic medical records of the hospital. Is that important? Yes, it is. Is that important for a hospital? No, it's not. Within 2 months, it will sit in retail clinics, like in a drugstore or in these kind of environments. In rural areas where we are able to treat patients, not to come to the hospital, but in their own community. And that could be a supermarket or whatever kind of other retail aspect, for instance. And it will not end here. This is a shocking device. Any idea what this is, somebody? This is the world's first blood-taking robot, completely autonomously taking your blood as they do in the lab in the hospital. It's a Dutch company, and I've traveled around in some of my keynotes with a small video where you see one of the first ones to put the needle and people would look the other way around. But now it's a commercial product. And guess what? They're not aiming at hospitals. They're aiming in retail stores to do so. That's the reality that we live in. And then we would say, well, yeah, sure, Lucien, that's fine. But let's be honest, the majority of our patients are at age. They don't know how technology works. This is the stereotypical image of elderly people, and this is the reality. We're admitting the first Rolling Stones fans into elderly homes, guys. And they use technology, smartphones, tablets, computers, all these things. And what they want to have the healthcare delivered in the comfort of their own home as much as possible. And that's happening. This is a pilot of Grace Hospital in Seattle, where this little self-driving cart, disclosure, there's still a driver in it, legally technical, just like with the Teslas. It would drive into your street when you have a consultation of the hospital. You would step into it and you would meet digital humans. And these are the ones that I brought with me from Australia and New Zealand that we've implemented in a couple of places that not only see you and hear you, but also have emotional recognition. So when they explain something to you and you raise your eyebrows, it would say, maybe I should explain it in a different language, a bit slightly different. And this is the world's first digital pharmacist that we've implemented in Nijmegen. Being able to choose as a patient whether or not it should be a male, a female, gender neutral, speaks 14 different languages, and kills about 3.5 to 4 hours of the average pharmacist in the hospital explaining on the phone things that already are on the website, but we've programmed that into these systems. That's the reality. In that little cart, also, the majority of the generic medications are in there, so you don't have to travel anymore to the pharmacist's office anymore. So lo and behold, my message in this is a bit like healthcare will, or actually has become a software business. And the collaboration that we should take, not only with technical universities, but also with startup companies and others, should be massively. And should be massively because of the different way of thinking, and still we think in healthcare that we're on this island. How many times I've heard, well, that's great for a package solution, but these are patients, these are people, that's different. No, it's not. Yes, there are aspects that are different, but the majority of the journey is logistical and could be digital for part. So within Deloitte, we've written a kind of white paper with 5 major shifts. The first one will be, we are going and we need to shift from healthcare to health. We're now treating things at the back end while we actually should be at the front end of it. The second of it is that we will virtualize healthcare in a huge fashion. Now we still run, that's the third one, research with cohorts of 10,000 people and patients. And the new era now is that every research can be done in an N-is-1 and personalize not only the research, but also the treatments for that. It also has something to do about the future of work. Where do we work? How long do we work? What kind of role do we have? What kind of education do we need? And the last one is all about the reimbursement systems. And digitization, digital transformation is making the world a lot smaller. And I think health also very soon becomes a software branch. Let me ask you a question. If you would see something like this, this is an healthcare organization, by the way, 10,000 square feet, US measurements, and there's primary care, the laboratory are there, radiology, mental counseling, dental, the optician, all of those. What kind of organization would you suppose that that is? If you would see something like this. Hospital? That's Walmart. Walmart Health, where they create, opposite to their regular Walmart stores, this Walmart Health Clinic, where you as a patient would step in and for $25 you would get a primary care visit. For $35 they would do the whole blood work, and for $45 they would run your radiology questions. The other thing what's interesting, we got a huge problem in healthcare and staffing and administrative burden in the Netherlands. The administrative burden for healthcare professionals is up to 40%. Walmart has 10%. They made it so easy for their professional staff that they all want to work over there. And they're now planning to enroll about like 120 of those in the US. But I also know that they now also collaborate with other chains worldwide, retail chains, to do the same also in the UK and in the Netherlands and maybe also in other places. This is another good example, I think. Walgreens, drugstore, offered 7,500 GPs office space for free in their drugstores or adjacent to their drugstores. And the rationale for that was, so if you go to the GP and on the way back, not only you can take your medication and the rest of the things, but also you would buy stuff. And the other rationale was, the patients already are here. It makes no sense to come to that rural area where the GP has his own office at their own fancy home, which is fine, but that's the rationale. And then we have Amazon. Amazon now buying for almost $4 billion One Medical, which is a primary care facility. And the interesting thing that happens to me a lot when I brag about Amazon is that almost never I get any feedback when I share something about what they're doing. Up until the moment when they kill something. And not patients, Shafi. But when recently they stopped Amazon Care, which was a healthcare facility for employers, and they stopped that. I got almost over 100 messages from friends and peers saying, see, even Amazon can fix it. No, they're not. They're just relocating their focus. They now know how that works. They've looked behind the curtains, and now they come back massively. Amazon is investing $12 billion in healthcare over the course of the next 4 months. Aiming also, by the way, on a European perspective. So if there's any ambition to talk to these guys, I really would encourage you to do so. And then we have the sandwich generation. Does that ring a bell with you guys? What the sandwich generation is? If not, this is how it looks like. A couple with two kids, two massively great jobs, four cars, 16 hobbies, and all of a sudden grandma gets sick. And what they will do is they will buy comfort for their grandparents and for themselves, because we still want to go on holiday, right? So that's the new generation that is going to invest in the amount of money needed to get these innovation up and running. So it's not the government, it's not the big tech companies, it's not the healthcare insurance companies, and all will put their fair part. But this, over the course of the next 5 to 10 years, is going to be massively. People are going to buy it themselves. And we should, because we know that the current system is unsustainable. We see technology stepping up, giving us opportunities, and the consumer, again, is awakening. The consumer in the patient. And they don't expect it anything more. And things can go very fast. Maybe some of you still remember that we sent text SMSs and we had to pay for it, remember? Whenever we send a message, we need to pay for that. And the guys that were working on that, the telecom operators, they thought, well, this is going through the roof. And they've already were busy dividing the bonuses. And then came WhatsApp. And in 6 weeks' time, the business model of sending text SMS was vanished, evaporated, no longer. So this was like how they looked like at that moment in time, as you can imagine. So why is this important? I think it's important because where airliners took 70 years to reach and transport 100 million people, Facebook gained 100 million users in 4 years and Instagram in 2 months. By the way, Pokemon Go in 2 days. That's also an interesting one. By the way, the biggest healthcare intervention ever was Pokemon Go. By the amount of people that were outside, the number of steps that they've taken out of their communities. So the question would be, if we know that the current trajectory, let's assume that that's the yellow one, we know that this is ending. The new one with new tech is still not good enough and we should wait maybe till there, or take the steps right now. Because the question would be, in my optics, are we going to be the next travel industry as healthcare? Or the next taxi industry? We've all know that Booking.com wasn't created by the travel branch and Uber wasn't created by the taxi branch, but that's still what's happening. So let's have a look at what determines your health. Your health is being determined by 20% by your DNA. We almost cannot fix anything on that. There's some kind of stuff that's happening, weird stuff, but 20%, 22% is based on your postal code. It matters. In some areas in the Netherlands, where you were born matters. 5 years life expectancy, 15 years quality of life. Then we got your behavior, eating well, doing your exercises, measurements, and then the combination of it. Only 6% of your health is being determined by the healthcare interventions. Only 6%. So tell me, why is it that we put 90% of our budget in that part? Why are we not flipping that around and making sure that we invest that same of money, or at least portion of that, into how to prevent diseases to occur, or to detect them earlier so we can intervene earlier? The average COPD exacerbation costs a hospital about 100,000 euros, generally. While treating them early on, it's about 10,000 euros. So we could treat as much as 10 patients more for them. So actually we need to go from healthcare into the other part, the health part. And of course, we should take the whole perspective of it and not talk about personalized medicine, which I like very much, but we should talk about personal health and not about value-based health care, value-based health. Any idea what this is? Japan. A ill-crafted flag of Japan. No, it's not. Thank you very much, Anne. It's the 1 hour. The 1 hour that a patient with Parkinson's, like Sarah Gigare from Sweden, is at their neurology office. And the other 8,765 hours in a year, she's on her own. So why is it that we in healthcare still think that we know what's best for our patients? Sure, we do patient journeys, remember? But a patient journey in the hospital isn't a patient journey. It's a patient journey of a patient in one institution, in one department. What we don't take into account is the journey of life of the patients, the broader perspective. And if we do so, maybe we can find triggers where we could intervene earlier, making sure that we can do things differently. So that was also how we innovated. In the early days, we innovated for patients. And rightfully so. That was, we hadn't other. Then we stepped into, and I've created Patients Included in 2011, to innovate together with patients. Not like at the end of a program to show them something and then ask them their feedback. No, right from the get-go. When we started, we would take patients in and their surroundings in the innovation process. And now we see patients innovate themselves. There is a group of patients that has created an artificial pancreas and has gotten FDA approval. And now, all of a sudden, the big companies are jumping on that system because they say, hey, wait a minute, it's exactly designed how patients would like to have that. So maybe we should ask patients sometimes how we can help, because the system that we have still is very divided in silos. And we're now going from a centralized system into a decentralized, but we should go into a networked organization. And that's also where other parts of society come in. And obviously, food is in there, as you can imagine, but also finance. We've created in the Netherlands a huge system where healthcare insurance companies, together with banks, would take over financial depths of patients. We know that a patient with a high financial debt or a citizen with a high financial debt is prone to use more healthcare. So together with the insurance company and the banks, we've taken over that debt. The higher interest rate was needed was being paid for by the healthcare insurance company that saw their total cost of healthcare lowered. And just imagine about the stress and all these things. So I think we should look into a broader perspective, obviously also into food, also to make food more personalized and also insight-driven. Shafi and I visited the expo over here. We saw how the University for Retail Clinics is able to see exactly where somebody is and what the choices are being made for them. I also need to talk a bit about healthcare, about employers, not healthcare employers, employers. We often think that the patient, the government, and insurance companies are paying for the costs of healthcare. And we leave out the fact that the employers also pay for healthcare. Maybe not for treatment, but in terms of lower productivity, facing up to the moment in time when people really have to step down. Lower productivity also because somebody has to come back to work and make sure to arrange that, but also to hire new people back and forth. So I think that we're living in an interesting moment in time. And if that picture resembles something to you, it says something about your day and age, as mine, by the way. I think this one is crucial. I often talk about the crocodile mouth. This is what's happening. Over the course of the next years, we see an increase, a doubling on healthcare demand, and a decrease of available staffing. And by 2035, that has gone so much that we have, again, a total standstill like we had on the peak of the pandemic. So my hunch is that we need to carve out about like 30% of healthcare, what we call healthcare now, and to demedicalize some of the low complexity stuff with technology on another place. So I'm not saying that the doctor or the nurse should head over to the retail clinics. We need them in hospitals. We need to train different people with new technology to do things that we also can do in a different place. Because we know how this works. These are Dutch graphs, how the demand is going to surge. And now we have 6 people to treat our patients, and then we only have 4 of them in the end of the day. So this is the new focus of the Dutch Ministry of Health for patients, self, if possible, at home, if possible, and digital, if possible. And everything they do is going to be measured against this. So they're now investing massively in prevention on a digital aspect, investing heavily in making sure that we can share the data also on a European level and stuff like that. Because we already have those building blocks. I know a lot of my system being my body. I've taken all these measurements. I know exactly which kind of meals are good for me and which kind are not. So in the end of the day, with that real-time measurement that I was talking about, combined with my insights, combined with what determines your health, I think I would get a different cash receipt than Shafi will get. Based on the measurements and the things that are good for me, beneficial, would lower it in price, and the other way around. And obviously we will go shopping for each other, but that's a different story. So we now see that data originally was based in healthcare on historic data in scientific literature. We're now in the midst of using recent data, data from this morning, data from yesterday, and we're now steaming up to that real-time data era where we are able to intervene because we now can prescribe already as opposed to predict, because that's the thing that we're looking at. And then we're looking at a lot of verbs like e-health and m-health and i-health, and it's 2022. Let's just call this digital health or health. And the thing we should take into account that we're not creating a new divide. In the Netherlands, research has shown that in elderly care, 1 in 10 employees in elderly care is not digital savvy. And in curative healthcare, like hospitals, it's 1 in 20. So we've got a huge challenge, not only for our patients, but also for our own staff. And the other part is this. Like I said in my introduction, I'm from a business family, and I've learned early on that if somebody's talking about me at a table and I'm not sitting at that table, I'm on the menu. Healthcare is strongly on the menu right now, on a lot of places and companies. Whereas and we've all seen this happening in travel industry, music and media, retail, there's one branch that everyone at one moment in their time will face, and that's healthcare. And they're not aiming for that high threat share part of healthcare, for instance, these companies. No, they're aiming at primary care cross-intersected with public health. And for my most recent book, I've created this graph of investments over 1 year time of companies in health and healthcare not coming from healthcare themselves. So not about the Philipses and the Medtronics, different kind of companies. And since I could add about like 140, 150 more. So in June this year, I invited a couple of friends of mine, some of which are underneath, to talk about how could we try to get opportunities where healthcare meets retail and the other way around. And sure enough, also, this is all about data as well. Like, we're now able to, in the most recent version of the software on the iPhone, to share the data with your spouse. Or to say, whenever my heart goes astray, there's a signal going to my kids or my physician, being able to not only see it and also have the aspect of it. The NHS now is loading their electronic medical records in Apple's health kit already. The same is now happening in Canada as well. And as you might have seen, Apple also now announced medication control in the operating system of a regular smartphone that you would buy at the corner of the street. That's the reality. So retail already is very big in that. And Amazon now is already one of the biggest pharmacists in the US. And this is an interesting one that I want to share with you, where Mark Cuban is one of the well-known investors in the US, has created Cost Plus, where he sells medication. And he closed deals with pharma companies, and let's enlarge them a bit, where he would say, so I offer you the price of production plus 15%. And these are some of the differences. He was neglected by pharma at first. And everybody would say, well, that's not going to happen. And we've seen that happening with Uber. We've seen that happening with Booking and all the other ones. Same is now true also for this part. And let's see how this works. There's two options, three. One, he gets acquired and the plug has been pulled. Two, he's going to be successful. That's massively going to change the way that we work in healthcare. Or three, some kind of a blend in that, well, let's see what happens. In Germany, there's now Autonova, which is the world's first fully digital healthcare insurance package that you can buy. And it's now not being bought by patients, that's the interesting one. It's being bought by employers offered as an employee benefit to their staff. And we're all fishing in the same pond for our employees. And so this is an option where you could really see how that plays out in the end. So is this something that's running fast? No, it's not. Many of those things that we've seen happening like 7 or 8 years ago now getting into reality. It takes that long and maybe even longer. And some would argue that an innovation in healthcare takes between 7 and 17 years to get mainstream. But the reality is this is true. Some of the technologies that we've used during the pandemic were there for 10 years already. But all of a sudden we started to use them because it was not possible. And this is the work about the innovation where we often need either the intrinsic will to change things or the need, like a burning platform. Then we need leadership to take on the challenge. Of course, we need some strategy, but don't overdo it. And then in healthcare, we start talking about process and technology back and forth. Well, the reality is, it's about culture. It's not about money. It's about us. It's about us willing to do these things and willing to change our own model and to be comfortable with the future for ourselves and our jobs. And then I also would like to add that we also always should implement a demolition team into it. And a demolition team is the team that, on authority of the CEO, comes to get rid of the old stuff that we have, because that's what makes innovation expensive. We use the new stuff and we keep the old ones up and running. So that's something that I think the next gentleman will talk about, implementation in healthcare, as I understand. So that's a perfect blend of that, I think. One of the last things that I want to talk about is inequality and equity in healthcare. What do these three technologies have in common? Color TV, access to the internet, and the smartphone, do you think? What is the commonality between those three technologies? We were the first ones in our neighborhood to have a color TV, and the neighbors came to us to watch color TV. I was one of the first ones to have internet access, and I've bought one of those very first iPhone ones for a lot of money. Now, it's a commodity. In the Netherlands, the average smartphone ownership is 1.3 per capita. My message here is that we have to strive for equality and equity, but every innovation starts at the front end with a happy few that are willing to pay for that. And now back for a minute to that sandwich generation that I mentioned. That's a mechanism that you also could start to use in it. Wrapping up a bit, I think healthcare is changing along these four axes. Healthcare is becoming delocalized. We are going to do things in a different place. It's becoming democratized because the data sits in the phones of patients that are able to share that with whomever they think is important for them. As to choose your own physician, your own hospital, to go differently with it, to sell your data to pharma companies or research. It will become digital. That's not only about the technology, but also about the speed. Once something is operationalized in one country, it's way easier to port that into a different country than setting up a whole new system for that. And then there is dollars. Big buckets of dollars pouring into healthcare from the side of healthcare. And I think one of the next sweet spots that we will see is the intersection of health and healthcare combined with food and retail. With that also touching on the preventional aspects where we will be able, if we choose wisely and if we understand each other good and try to create good working projects out of that, to make sure that we also get more in front of the problem as opposed to fixing it at the end, that we need great rebels for that. So wrapping up, I think the shift already is happening. It's not something that is coming, it's there already. We have huge challenges in terms of staffing and budget, we know that. We're not going to solve that with a bit better and a bit cheaper and a bit more efficient and a bit, you know, on all those bits. We should do our bit as well, but we also should take big stances to try to figure that out. And I think carving out up to 30% out of hospitals in a different place by different people could work. Digitization will drive that. Even though we don't want it, this will happen also with or without us. I think the government needs to clear the way in terms of being able to share data, have the right policy and regulation. On a European level, we now got the European Health Data Act. That is going to change massively, I think. And I also think that retail now is shifting gears and also new entrants are stepping into that. In the past 7 years, we've built a digital fundamentals, so to say. I think the next 7 years will be the grounding fundamentals for retail. And I think that innovation and technology is not the problem, but the implementation in the end of the day is. Let me wrap up with a small video, which is all about innovation. There's a metaphor in it, and I'll get back to you after that. Let's have it.
She packed my bags last night, pre-flight. 0 hour, 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. It's lonely out in space on such a timeless flight. I think it's gonna be a long, long time.
So the metaphor obviously is everybody thought it was impossible up until the moment in time when somebody stepped up who did not know. Thank you very much.
Dámy a páni, Lucien Engelen, inovačný stratég v oblasti zdravia. It was really amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have any questions? Máme nejaké otázky z publika, lebo zatiaľ sme v aplikácii Slovakia Tech otázku pro Luciana nenašli, tak možno, že sa chcete niečo aj opýtať, čo vás zaujalo? Maybe I will... Ano?
Sure.
Máme tu predsa len jednu otázočku, nech sa páči.
The question is whether rewarding will be one of the solutions, and it definitely is. And rewarding can have many faces, of course. If I look into the supermarkets, that would be that the things that are beneficial for you, which now often are more expensive, would be lowered. There's a project running in Belgium by Ahold Delhaize already that if you buy healthy products, you get more points, and with those points, you can buy again new products for that, healthy product for that. So rewarding is one. We now also see that there's a couple of healthcare insurance companies that are giving you watches and all kinds of other stuff. In return, you should deliver them their data. So I think we're at the brink of these kind of new models. I think it's a book that we will be writing all together right now in the next, let's say, 3 to 4 years. But there should be a rewarding in whatever kind of sense, I think. Yeah, absolutely. And if you can show my slides again, I'll also can refer you to my LinkedIn profile. If there's any question, you could...
Ak sa to dá, skúsime sa vrátiť, áno, k tomuto profilu, Luciana.
If you point out to the QR code, you're getting to my LinkedIn profile. And I'm happy to share the slides with you as well if you drop me a line. Because that's the other thing. We need to organize. This is not something for the Netherlands or for the UK or for Slovakia. Most generic, we as species are pretty common. The models differ, and your politics differ, and your reimbursement systems differ. But that's the thing that's happening now, and we've seen that happening with tech companies in other areas. They will change the way how we interact in our own everyday life. And there's two ways to handle that. One is wait and see what happens. And I've always learned is to reach out myself and to try to make the best of it, and in that way also to be able to steer it in the direction that I think is needed, ethically, financially, and also professionally.
Maybe another question from audience. Máme tu ešte nejakú otázočku, niekoho niečo zaujíma, kto by sa chcel niečo spýtať?
And otherwise, grab me at the coffee.
Okay, maybe on coffee. Thank you, we heard great ideas and thoughts. It was amazing. Lucien Engelen.
Thank you very much.
Have a nice day.